in this book in terms of his ability to professionalize the gallery. Here he is on the, quote, Ferris Gallery yacht, which is all a construct. This is, the boat belongs to photographer William Claxton's brother. They've put these letters Ferris Gallery on the back of this boat and stocked it with bathing suit clad beauties, including Peggy Moffat, William Claxton's wife at the time, all the time, and Irving Blum in his blue blazer and his white pants, looking like he's owning a yacht. And of course, none of them had any money, let alone a yacht. But he knew about the image. He was very perceptive about how important image was then and would come to be, certainly in the post-Warhol era.
It's interesting you mentioned Peggy Moffat. The artwork carried over into dress design with Rudy Gernreich and his doing the strange bathing suits with the nudity.
Yes, well, I wanted this to be about not just the artist, but the artist's friends. I mean, the book is about the artists, it's about the 60s, first and foremost, the artists who lived here and created a scene, and their friends who were, you know, Rudy Gernreich was very much a part of that. He used to have fabulous parties at his house and invite the artists to be a part of it. And they loved that, of course, with all those beautiful models walking around. And I think the spirit of experimentation, of course, and the permissive environment of Los Angeles that allowed architects, designers, musicians, fashion designers, to just really try something new. That was here, and of course it's Rudy Gernreich, and of course it's Frank Gehry, who's a whole chapter in my book.
Because he was such an influence, and they influenced him.
Yes, and he's so generous in his giving credit to the artists for changing his work. Frank Gehry was, you know, divorced. He'd left a corporate situation to start his own firm, and he looked at the way these artists lived in their studios with their unfinished walls and their open studs on the walls, and he thought this is an interesting thing. He thought they were so much more experimental and free in the way they could conceptualize interior and exterior space, and it changed his work forever.
Well, we mentioned Dennis Hopper, but I told you that I have probably the only oil painting Dennis did when he was 21 that did not get burnt in the Bel Air fire.
Yes, which is a fantastic thing.
Yeah.
And quite an important thing for you to hang on to.
And truly only because he was at one as my husband was a film director there doing the Cheyennes and Mavericks with Dennis. And we were in the same building.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Well, there's no doubt that Dennis was so insightful about the way art looked and got it. I mean, I did an interview with him, a few interviews with him, and he's in the book a lot.
Yeah,
but he talks about how he got it. Like the minute he went to Vincent Price's house and he saw that collection of modern art, which put off a lot of people at that time, he said he got it immediately.
Yeah, as well as he put it into the writing because he did a great script, The Last Picture Show, that became a film, but it never. At that point, he may have been in his sort of drug period.
Yes,
and it should have been a better film. And more recognizable as a great work of art. Anyhow, here we go back into the photographs that were done at this time.
Yes.
Such as?
Well, that's the interior of the Beanery, a piece that where Ed Kienholz actually recreated Barney's Beanery almost exactly in many ways, but populated it with these mannequins that wore clocks as heads. All to a set to a certain time. It was an absolutely remarkable thing. It was shown here, then it went to New York, and it was shown in the Virginia Dwan Gallery there, her first show when she moved to New York. Virginia Dwan's another important gallery who was here in the 60s, and I write quite a lot about that. But that Kienholz Barnett Beanery is now in a museum in Europe, and we don't get to see it anymore.
And now we have here?
That's young Frank Gehry.
Yeah. And his pipe.
And his cigar.
Cigar, rather. Yeah. Did he paint or do anything besides being an great architect?
Well, he always does drawings,
which
are very artistic, and he has exhibited them a lot, and he's also made some sculpture.
I love the fact that towards the end you start to say what some of these paintings did become. I mean, what their value, such as the work of, who is it, James Tunnell.
James Turrell.
Turrell.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. And his light boxes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, one of the things I say is that at the many of these artists today are terribly famous. John Baldessari, Ed Ruscha, James Turrell. Mm-hmm. These are Robert Irwin. These are people who have huge international reputations.
Yeah.
But no one knows how small and intimate their origins were. The scene. I mean, really, people don't know.
Yeah.
What created the atmosphere and how that atmosphere affected their work. However, all the artists in the book, their auction sales records are from L.A. in the 1960s. Bruce Nauman, David Hockney, these are people who are not necessarily thought of as L.A. artists, but still, even today, it's that work from the 60s in L.A. that has gotten the multi-million dollar price tag.
I mentioned Helen Pashkin.
Pashkin, yes.
And her work with plastic.
Yes. And she has been really enjoying a kind of resurrection of her career since there's a new interest in art of this period. I mean, it's not just my book. I mean, the show at the Getty and shows around town at different museums. I mean, she's really enjoying a lot of attention.
Also,
now.
You talk about how many museums now there are in Los Angeles, from LACMA to David Geffen's MoCA downtown. I mean, it's just incredible how they have all sort of taken root and blossomed.
Well, what I think many people do not know is that LACMA was opened in 1965. That's the LA County Museum of Art on Wilshire Boulevard. Mm-hmm. That prior to 1965, the only two museum was really the part of the art museum that was part of the LA, what is now the Natural History Museum. So you'd go down there to see the paintings, but you'd also see the dinosaurs and the science exhibit. Yeah. It was all one thing. And then there was the Pasadena Art Museum, but that was an old Chinese-style mansion that had belonged to an art dealer. It wasn't a full-fledged museum. So people don't really know that L.A. didn't have any cultural center whatsoever until the mid-60s.
Of course, there was the Huntington Art Museum that was part of the Huntington Library. But
yes,
that was still somebody's former home, like the Frick Museum is in New York.
Exactly. It wasn't a museum with a permanent collection and a rotating series of exhibitions. LACMA is the first standalone art museum dedicated to the collection and exhibition of art, and not just contemporary and modern, of course, but all kinds of art.
Now, you originally, as we met, the book on Georgia O'Keeffe. Was she ever part of this 1960s scene?
Well, funnily enough, the art dealer Rolf Nelson, who's in my book, showed her huge, long Sky Above Clouds painting from the 60s and tried to get, I think it was $75,000 for it at the time, which would have been a huge amount of money. Mm-hmm. But by the mid-1960s, Georgia O'Keeffe was considered the most important woman artist, and she thought of herself as the most important artist working in America. It wasn't an out-of-sight figure. But he could not sell that painting in Los Angeles, and ultimately it went to the Chicago Art Institute.
Oh, so she did not really have a startling career here.
No, she did not.
Yeah. But tell me about your art. What did you work in?
Oh, I haven't done any art since I was in college, and all of my interest in art has been channeled into writing about art, and I've done that for a very long time, as you know.
Yeah.
But I do think sometimes if you start as an artist, you wind up a little bit more sympathetic to the goals of the artist.
I would think also there'd be times where the hand would sketch because that's what you're seeing, that's what you're feeling.
Not so much. I mean, especially now that we have the phone camera.
Yeah.
Now, I used to maybe make a sketch of something I was looking at in a gallery. Now I just can take my phone and press the button and capture it that way and bring it back to my office and write about it.
Does that change your instinctive feeling when you see a painting? To me, you're enveloped. To take just a snapshot of it is a dismissal.
I don't think it's a dismissal, but it's a different experience.
Yeah.
And I feel very certain that I am of the opinion that a photograph of a painting is certainly not the same as looking at a painting.
Yeah.
And that's one of the losses we've incurred through the digital age, is that people go on the internet and they see more art than they could ever have seen at any time in history before this.
Right.
However, they don't actually see the art. They see these digital reproductions, which make the art bigger or smaller, or you don't get the actual experience of looking at the painting, which is different.
It is definitely different. Would you autograph my book, Anna? And
with pleasure.
Thank you, Hunter. And it really is an extremely wonderful book to experience and to go through the years with these men. And I should tell our friends that you have a timeline in the beginning of what was going on in the art world during that period, 1963 to the end, 1969 of that period. Meanwhile, if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier, or you can visit us on YouTube, where the shows have been digitized and put on the web. But I do have to hold up Lynn Keenholz's book, because it is a masterpiece of what she did and working with people to actually, as was said, it's an encyclopedia of art in up to the 1980s. And of course, being married to one of the top artists didn't hurt either. But whatever you can do, support that library. Now, also support museums, because there is a great museum out in the Santa Ana College having a showing of portraits of a woman named Joan Quinn. Well, she was friendly with Billy Al, and she was friendly with David Hockney. And I guess she would say to them, come and paint me, and she would pay them. But what those paintings are worth today? Better than getting diamonds, I would say. Meanwhile, great little college there, Santa Ana College, and a charming museum. Same thing with Pepperdine, has a great museum there, the Frederick Wiseman Gallery. So combine art, read Rebels in Paradise, and you'll get the full experience. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.